Hey, what's going on? What's going on? Welcome, welcome to another episode of After Dark with Sean Cornelius. I am your host, the romantic funny man, Sean Cornelius. And tonight's show got a very, very special show. I say that about all the shows, but tonight I really mean it. This is going to be a doozy of a show. But before I get into it, definitely want to ask you guys to do me that solid like you always do. Please share this show because you're going to want to, because by the time this show's over, you're like, "Ooh, I'm glad I shared this to all my people." Hello, Shell T. What's up, Producer Smoke? Everybody out there. Denise, how are you? The program director. And so, yeah, let's get into this, man. Let's get into it. Don't want to waste any time. Tonight's show is going to be very entertaining, very entertaining. I have a gentleman coming on the show. Actually, I have several folks coming on to sit down and chat with me for the show. And my main guest is an all-around talent, singer, dancer, he's an actor, he's a comedian. He's connected to the Apollo, the legendary Apollo. And it's just going to be fun for me. This is the first time actually sitting down with this brother and just kind of just chopping it up. But, you know, I've seen his work, and I guess that's why I wanted to have him on the show. And you're going to love him. Hello, Dion, my family in South Carolina. So let's go ahead and get into it because I don't want to hold him up and keep him waiting in the green room any longer. Please welcome to the show CP Lacey. CP.
Hey, CP, they just introduced you, man.
Oh,
CP, they introduced you.
He's not there.
Let me go on and talk to the people until you get here, okay? All right, I'm going to go on.
Sean.
What's up, Stevie?
Everything is good, my brother. How are you?
I'm blessed, man. I didn't know you were going to be here tonight.
Well, I'm hanging out at my boy CP Lacey's house, and we're having a little eggnog.
Yeah,
if you know what I mean.
Yeah, you sure it's eggnog they're giving you, brother?
Well, I think they might have made a little bit of color to it, some of that brown color in the eggnog. But
ladies and gentlemen, no, I just got to listen. Let me introduce you first. So for those that don't know, please welcome Stevie Wonder to my show.
Hi, yeah. Everybody. I just want to say Merry, Merry, Merry. Oh, that was yesterday.
Yeah, that was a while ago, Stevie. We need to this week. But thank you, though, for filling in really quickly for CP, man.
He'll be down in a couple of seconds. As a matter of fact, I believe he's closer than we think. Wait a second. CP, are you there? Are you there, CP? Well, actually,
ladies and gentlemen.
Hi, man. What's up, Sean?
What's good? Ladies and gentlemen, here he is, the real CP Lacey. Welcome to the show, man.
How you like my Stevie Wonder hair?
The hair look, it look, and it fits, brother. It fits. It works. How you been, brother?
Great to be on your show, man. I want to say hi to all your listeners, all your viewers. And like you said, make sure you share this one because this one's going to be off the chain. I love doing interviews because I always make my interviewer very nervous because he don't know what direction we're going to take this show.
And you know what's so cool about that? I don't even care. I don't
there
even
you
care. You know, I'm just all about having fun, and you're a fun dude and such a talent. So I'm humbled to have you, brother. I told the folks, I gave them a little bit of your bio, man. You've been doing things for quite some time. So let's start it off, and then so we can continue to get into the fun with you. How long have you been entertaining or had that entertainer, that spirit in you?
Well, I've been doing the impersonations since what? Since Billie Jean. That's okay. What, 83? I've been doing the impersonations since 1983, and but I've been performing all of my life, basically most of my life.
And how did it just drop on you? Natural talent, natural ability. Did somebody see it and said, "Hey, see you that was a great so and so. That was a great Michael Jackson. You should do this."
No, I wasn't even doing Michael yet. What happened was, here's the story that I give everyone, and it's a true story. When I was about 5 or 6 years old, my father's in the Navy. My mother's a stay-home wife, yada, yada, yada. And every time he'd come home from sea around me, every, you know, 2 or 3 and a half, 4 weeks, he'd come back from sea. And he'd bring all the sailors to our house for the house parties, right? And my mother would wake me up because she knew I could sing, you know, from school plays and stuff. I'm about 6 years old, first grade, whatever. And she'd wake me up around 11:30 to entertain the troops. Mm. And I remember the first time she did it. She woke me up. Hey, wait, wake up. We want you to sing. I'm standing in the middle of the floor. My mother's friends, my father's friends, everybody's at the house. And I start singing all these songs. Next thing you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I said, at 6 years old, I know what I'm going to do. Yeah. And like, I love to sing. Plus I can get paid and buy milk and cookies. Come on, man.
Wow, that's awesome. That's awesome. And then you just develop, because I know, again, I know you do several things. I know you do, you know, you are a comedian,
mm-hmm.
and you are a singer, and you dance, and you connect, you're connected to one of the most famous places ever in history, the Apollo Theater
in
New York City. Now, how did that come about, man?
Well, first of all, I'll tell you, for those who are watching who don't know how I'm connected at the Apollo, I'm the guy who, when you start getting booed, I'm the guy who comes out and kick you off the stage. You've seen the show. It's showtime at the Apollo.
Yes,
I'm that guy who comes and kick you off. Now, the original guy was Sandman Sims. Mm-hmm. What happened was, back in the early 90s, there was a movie called Taps with Gregory Hines, Sandman Sims, Honey Coles. All the great hoofers were in this movie. And I had won 6 times at the world famous Apollo Theater doing James Brown. You know, doing my impersonation with all the fancy footwork and everything.
Right.
And the originator of Amateur Night at the Apollo, Mr. Ralph Cooper Sr., he liked my fancy footwork. And since Sandman was leaving to go to Hollywood to film this movie for a few weeks, he asked me, CP, I like your footwork. Would you like to fill in for Sandman Sims? Can you tap? Now, of course, in show business, if they ask you, can you tightrope walk? The answer is yes.
Yeah,
I can tap dance, of course. I was tap dancing just yesterday.
Exactly.
Never put a pair of tap shoes on in my life. He said, okay, then, you've got the job. I came in, filled in for Sandman that few weeks. That few weeks turned into, what is this, my 35th year over there at the world-famous Apollo Theater. Wow. Destroying people's dreams.
Congratulations for destroying people's dreams, man.
Thank you, man, of my own heart. That's
a legendary job, man. Because we all are familiar with Sandman Sims, you know, Sandman. So that's great. Okay, that's cool. Connected with all of the shows and things on that level. Off over your shoulder, the poster, man, is amazing. Because you have all of these guys, the other side.
Oh, yeah.
not the dude at the top, but all of the guys at the bottom, the people at the bottom, those are all of your characters.
And those are some of my characters. I do over 30, but they couldn't fit on the banner. You have Sammy Davis, Michael, President Obama, Stevie Wonder, Kanye, Prince. I don't know if Prince is too low. Snoop Dogg, James Brown. I do Lionel Richie. I do a host of others. Tina Turner, When the Money's Right.
Yeah, I was going to say, you just do Tina Turner, period, but it's got to be a paid gig.
Oh, there got to be some zeros on the check.
Fantastic, fantastic. So when you started knowing that you could do these characters, did you look at some of the greats before you to study? Because that's what they say. If you want to be great at something, you study the greats. You put your twist on what the greats. Did you look at some of those impersonators and put their twist on your stuff?
Mm-hmm. But let's not get it out of a genealogy or chronology.
I'm gonna let you fight with that one, brother.
Okay, we're not gonna get it twisted. Is a better word. I was studying these characters, these icons, before I even knew I was going to be an impersonator. Okay. I was studying them because I wanted to be in show business, like from 6. So I did study the everybody. I study everybody, like you said, from Sammy Davis Jr. to Gene Kelly. I studied everyone to be ready when my Broadway, which catapulted me to television, which catapulted me to movies. I wanted to be ready, you know, when that happened. So right. I studied these icons not to be an impersonator, but to learn what to do on stage.
Yeah. And do you do any of the newer celebs? In your act now?
I've been good enough to do during the pandemic. I'm good enough to do Lil Wayne, Bruno Mars, you know, because I am much taller than both of them. But on a camera screen, you can't tell. But those characters, I would never be able to pull off in real life. Imagine me coming there, almost 6 feet tall. To my, hi, I'm Lil Wayne.
Yeah, man, I'm Lil Wayne.
You gotta get your tall self out of here.
Well, you got his speech down. That's awesome. Jump into it. Now, is it easy for you to jump in and out of those characters? Because, like, okay, now we're doing this interview, and obviously you don't have time to go back and change, put on costumes. But vocally, spiritually, can you just drift in and out of certain characters?
That's a question that a lot of people don't ask me, and I'm glad they don't, because I'm kind of quirky. People ask, what is your quirk? Celebrities have quirks. And I think my quirk is, I don't even think about doing the characters without the props and full regalia. I feel naked just standing up here saying, right, hey, babe, I'm Sammy Davis Jr., man, without the wig and the glasses. And, you know, it just feels like I'm missing something. I just did Wayne and I just did Sammy. But yeah, generally, I don't do, you know, because there's a guy, his name is Rich Little.
Yes.
What you call an impressionist. He is not an impersonator.
Right.
I'm an impersonator. That means I put on everything.
Mm-hmm.
Rich Little will throw on a feather in his hat and say, how, I'm Tonto, you know.
Yes.
But that's an impression. I don't do impressions. I do impersonations.
Right. He was one of the early ones that I used to love back
in the day. Genius guy.
Yeah. Was one of the ones that I saw that was great. And from time to time, CP, because we're on different platforms, folks will drop comments and or questions, and I'm going to, you know, drop them in because they're interested in finding out about my guests. So here's one from my brother Derek Skinner. Who's the most difficult, and then who's the most easiest to impersonate for you?
Okay, let's see. I'll tell you right away. The easiest is the Godfather of Soul, James Brown, because James Brown, I am James Brown. Ever since I was 7 years old, I've been James Brown. But I guess the most difficult would be, I'd have to say the most difficult would be Prince.
And what makes Prince so difficult?
The fact that he's so laid back. Watch this now. He's so laid back, but he's so in your face without even trying. I have to try to be in your face, but Prince can stand in the middle of a stage and just strum that guitar, and people are losing their minds.
Yes.
But I have to jump around, do splits, twirl around, you know, because if I stand in the middle of the stage and just strum a guitar, people think, this guy, that's not a good Prince. You know right. what I mean?
Right. Now, very high energetic. Yes. Very. Do you, like, if you put Michael, do you do a show where you put Michael, Prince, James on the same show that you do? Do you have a show where you do that? Now, that's a very energetic, intense show.
I certainly do. And the kicker of it is, what makes the audience so intrigued with my show and get lost in the magic is because I never go behind a smoke screen. I never go behind a partition like this. I'm right center stage, and I will transform right before your very eyes from Michael to whoever. And I'm telling jokes in between because I am a comedian. So I'm telling jokes before you know it. Michael Jackson is talking to you, you know what I'm saying? Then all of a sudden, before you know it, you're looking at the Godfather of Soul, James Brown, with some jokes in between. You're like, how did he do that?
Yes.
It's a gift.
Yes, yes, you are blessed, brother, and you bless others, that's one of the most beautiful things about what you do and what artists do when they take your craft and bless other people to make them happy. I've seen your work, so much of your work. Just last night, I was watching a clip of your James Brown at the Apollo and also the Michael Jackson. And you have a full band. You have the band, the girls, and the whole cadence down with the band. And we know how James was about with his band and the timing of his directives and things on that level. It must have taken a lot. You got to be dedicated to what you're doing to get those things, because people seeing people dance on the street, oh, that's not James Brown. But when you transform, it's the whole thing.
So when I have to because of the fact that James Brown would not let anyone not know that he had a standard that was up here, way up there, you know. So, and if you come after James Brown, you can't come with your shoes, you know, not shine. You can't have your pants, you know, too low water. You have to have your pants nice and high water. You know, you have to, everything has to be on point.
Yes.
Details.
Yes.
Details.
Yes. And going from Michael, who studied James, Prince, who studied James, Bruno and Usher, and all those guys who studied Mike, you see the tightness, the work that Michael put in. Now, what about somebody like Lionel Richie, who's a smooth cat?
Is it okay if I remove this Stevie Wonder? I'm not really this complexion. Can I take the Stevie Wonder off while you talk?
Man, do what you do, brother.
Thank you. I'm feeling like Casper the Ghost up here.
it's all good. Are you going to transform again into something else?
I'm going to throw me in the green room. People don't want to see this.
No, listen, man, this is what you do. So, you know what? I think it's kind of cool for people to have to see what actually has to happen. If you
I used to close my dressing room to press people because they really got a kick out of watching me transform into my characters. And I said, wait a second. You guys are letting everybody know the magic. I can't let other impersonators know the magic.
Right, you know what you're doing. All right, so I'm going to put you in for a second. I'm going to say something, and I'll bring you right back.
Thank you.
Yeah, no problem, brother. See, that's a real professional. You have to, you know, so far, again, if you guys would like to see CP stuff, just YouTube him and check out some of his, he's got a lot of videos up of some of this, the guys that were behind him, the Michael, the James, the Prince, the Lionel. He did an awesome video of Michael coming back. I thought I was singing happy birthday, but he'll tell you about it when he comes back. But Michael came back and did something, and then he actually wrote, that's what I'm going to talk to him about when he gets back in here, the actual video that he did. And because I don't want to say anything wrong. I'm not sure if it was a charity or it was really a nice song that he wrote, pre-produced, wrote, and did everything, the music. I had all of that stuff. So as soon as he gives me the thumbs up and he's ready to come on back through, then we're gonna bring him back in and handle his business. I'm glad you guys are tuning in. Again, don't forget to share everything. Don't forget to share this as you watch it, because it's an awesome situation. And we're going to pop this up on really quick. Instagram is GoCPLazy. And you guys are going to see so much that I'm talking about. And to see him live, though, is the thing to see him live. So I believe our next is ready. So let's bring him back on it. Hey, man.
Oh, I feel good. Look at him.
James.
Brother Sean, let me just say one thing from the bottom of my heart. And I really mean this. CP will be back in a minute. But I just want to say one thing before we even get started. I just want to say, I was one tater bread loaning me. You know what I'm saying?
I appreciate that, Brother James, but I have no idea what you just said, but I know it was really, really serious.
I meant that from the heart, brother. Meant it from the heart. Meant it from the heart.
Brother James, how you been?
I've been good, brother. I've been good. It's good up here in heaven. I talked to what's his name? Johnny Cash just a few minutes ago. Okay. And he was doing good. He said, you know, I love Johnny Cash, but he over here making jokes. I hear the trainer coming, rolling around the bend. I snort a line. I said, James, you can't be snorting. Johnny, you can't be snorting no lines up here. No, this is heaven. You can't be doing that.
That's not cool. So, hey, Brother James, now CP and I were talking about you a minute ago, and we know what you were able to do on the hard floors on the stage. How hard is it to do all the things you did on the clouds, brother?
Brother, let me tell you one thing. Even before I left Earth, I stopped doing splits. I stopped doing splits on the ground. If you remember, I was doing them jump up in the air split. They call it air split.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Yes, sir.
And those are really easy to do up here and have them. The big man like when I do that. Because he don't like me, you know, punching holes in the clouds and everything going down on them floor splits. It's bad for business up here.
Yeah, that's what I was going to tell. So do you guys and Michael and Prince and Whitney, you guys get together? Luther, you guys get up there and do a little concert, a little jam?
Well, every now and then, because they live on the other side, you know, their sides for exclusives, which I live on, and their sides for, you know, regular people, you know, Michael Jackson, Prince, Whitney, all them people you said, you know, I'm in a different class, you know, me and Little Richard, who happened to be the architect of rock and roll, we paved the way for them guys. So there's a place for me,
there's a place for people like me, Little Richard, the Beatles. Okay. They changed the world. Changed the world.
Okay.
Changed the world.
Wow, they separated like that.
Changed the world.
So Michael is not like the king up there. All right, cool.
Changed the world.
So what do you do during your time up there when you're not just dancing and singing?
Well, we do a lot of if you read your Bible, you'll know that what we do is just sit around and sing all day. We sang a lot of songs, a lot of praise songs to the Most High, and it's an enjoyable thing. You'll love it.
Brother James, let me ask you a question. What do you think about some of the artists, the younger artists today, they're still showing you tributes, doing tributes, using the music, and how does that feel to you? Because you did something while you were down here.
I'm gonna tell you like it started out when the first hip hoppers first started, you know, stealing my music. They didn't use the word stealing. They called it
sampling.
Sampling. Thank you very much. They call it sampling, but they was using my music. I didn't mind that. But then when they said that they're giving me some life, that's when I took offense. If you're giving me so much life, why you got to use my music to give me life? You know what I'm saying? Use your own music. But now, to tell you the truth, brother, I don't care what they do. It's a whole different mindset up here. Whole different mindset. Don't matter whether they use my music or not.
Yeah, I want to tell you something. Have you sat up with Chadwick Boseman, Brother Boseman, who played you to the T and gave you so much love in the Get On Up film? Have you sat and talked with that brother?
I haven't had a conversation with the brother yet, but I want to give him accolades because, first of all, a lot of people were sending me letters saying, well, James, how come you didn't use that brother C.P. Lacey? How come you didn't use him? But what happened was, I understand Hollywood. It's box office. C.P. Lacey wouldn't have filled up them seats in the theater like Boseman would have done, riding on the back of that number 32 movie he did. Yeah, rest in peace.
But that was 42. That was
Chad. And I just want to say 42. One thing about that is the brother Chad was over. He was at least 6 feet tall. So a brother who can do 6 feet tall and play me, I was 5'6" and a half. I give him all the props in the world. All the props in the world. He made me look good.
Beautiful, rest in peace. Man. Yes, and that was 42. He played Jackie Robinson. Didn't mean to correct you, but you know, Jackie might walk up on you and correct you, and it was number 42.
So. Oh, did I say 32?
Yeah, you said 32, brother.
Yeah, it's 32, dog. On it, I'm James Brown.
Hey, James.
32. He need 10 more.
I want to thank you for stopping through, James, man. I know you just came through.
I'm sorry. Oh, my God.
That was great.
Bro. You're a maniac, man. Call me out like that. Thank you very much.
Oh, my God. No problem.
I knew it was 32. Look at you trying to save face. I knew it was 32. I was trying to make a funny. No, too late.
Man, too late. So man, listen. This
is fun.
Your entertainment skills and the things you do have taken you all over the country, correct?
All over the world. You were right when you almost said world.
I almost said world. I didn't, you know. The places you've been and the things you've done. Is there anything about this that kind of gets you in a not so positive energy? I've been a stand-up comic for 28 years. I'm a music person. I'm a singer. So I know the ups and downs. Is there anything that you see that really kind of makes you go, you know, if this wasn't a part of this, it would be all right?
You mean like in my travels, like seeing what other cultures and how it affects me?
Yeah, the entertainment game within, because I know being able to travel is a great thing, to see other people, to live. That's a positive to what we do. But in those kind of things, what do you, is there anything that you're just like, wow, if this wasn't part of the industry, this would be perfect, even though we know not in a perfect world.
Okay, so we're gonna leave it to if it wasn't in the industry, as opposed to just worldwide problem.
Yes.
Okay,
yeah.
Industry. I'd say, and there's nothing I could do about this, and I'm not gonna mention any names, if certain conglomerates did not buy up and monopolize the industry, a lot more people would be heard on the radio than the seven that you hear every day for 3 months. And then maybe a new one will crop up.
Right.
But
right.
That's the industry that we live in today. Radio, television, movies, you can name the five big conglomerates that run this entire structure. And if you're not in bed with them, you don't get a shot. You just don't.
Right.
Back in the day, you know, you could listen to the radio and you're hear like 13 songs before you hear another one play that you heard prior to that. Now, every seventh song is the first one you heard already.
Yeah.
And you might say, wow, I wonder why that is. Well, that you have to talk to the people at and the people at, because they own the radio stations, they yes. own the record companies, and they own the venues.
Yeah, yeah. So CP, usually around this time, I get ready to take a break. So at the end of this first half, we're going to do it in the second half too. But for someone that's got the skills that you have, a younger artist that wants to get involved with this type of thing, get in type with this type of part of the industry, what advice would you give them about the industry? I know you just gave you dropped the jewel, but what would you, as far as specifically impersonator, that kind of thing?
That's an awesome question. And I'm going to give you the answer that I give everybody. I have a master class that's coming up. It's in development now. And come to my web place where I have my master classes in show business, stage presence, acting, dance, hair, makeup, all the intricacies of the entertainment and the performing arts business. I have master classes, and I'm going to have other masters, not just myself, other masters teaching those master classes. All right. And I'll leave my email address for those of you who are interested in learning from a master. And I guarantee you, with the stuff that I have under my belt, you will breeze through those auditions, and they will say to you, where in the world have you been all my life? Cool. I learned from the masters. I have it in here.
Cool. Now, I was talking while you were in the dressing room or the green room, and James came out, and forgive me, because I was watching it late one night. You did a song where I believe you wrote the song, you edited the song, you produced the song, you did the vocals as Michael, and it was like a healing, a song for healing, a song of, could you please tell them about that and remind me of the title, because I thought that was great.
Yeah. This was during I think I wrote it pre-pandemic. No, I didn't. Did I write it? No, I wrote it after the pandemic had started. I was thinking of it pre-pandemic, and then it morphed into the song that it was. It was a song about peace and healing. The song is called, of course, Where is the Love? And it's where Michael Jackson is sitting on a cloud, and yes. he's looking through the clouds at Earth, and he's looking at all the racial tension. He's looking at all the injustices, the judicial injustices, all of the racism and all this stuff, and just people against people. And Michael had a heart for people. You can hear it in all of his stuff. So I said, well, let's let Michael just revisit Earth and sing this song. So he's singing the song as he's walking through different situations. And it's not for today, it's for yesterday too. You see some images of Hiroshima. You see images of Brother Floyd. You just see images of world-renowned Gandhi, not just, you know, the right. Urban plight. It's just a world plight that he's singing, you know, speaking to the heart of people. Where is the love? And thank you for bringing that up. It was something on my mind that I had to do.
Hey, man, I thought that was awesome, because I know you mentioned that you did that all, you know, you did everything on that, you know, from the writing of the song, the music and all that. So it's up now. Thank you, producer Smoke. CP shows Where is the Love? And you can check that out. So CP, here's what we're going to do, man. We're going to take a short break, come right back. Do I need to put you back in the green room? But the second half of the show, you watched it. You've been here. It's all about love. It's all about romance. It's all about relationships. But your opinion. So are you okay hanging out?
I'm okay hanging out. And wifey is in earshot. So I got to make sure these answers are on point.
Well, you know what to do. Listen, if you got to be somebody else, baby, that wasn't me. That was Jay. That was Prince. All right, we're going to take a short break.
What was that Jamaican song? It wasn't me.
It wasn't me. We're gonna take a short one and come right back with more CP Lacey on After Dark with Sean Cornelius. Stay right where you are.
Can I ask you a question?
Yeah, of course.
I love you. Do you love me?
What's your definition of love?
It was just yesterday that you walked away from me.
We're back on the show, and CP is taking a second to take care of some things technically, but we're gonna bring him back and sit down and have a good time with him. I see what's up, Sugar, TB, Poland, Denise Wilkerson, Mike Jones, Sharon Murray, Derek Reed, how you doing? Taisha Green, CJ, Stevie, what's up? Starla Anderson, Jacqueline Victoria, Lisa Artwell, David Velasquez. I feel like the ladies, remember that show, The Magic Garden? If you're old enough to remember the show, The Magic Garden, when they used to say, I see Susan and Karen and Tommy and Timmy, all those kind of people. So that's what I was doing, just giving shouts out. And don't forget, you guys, you can share this, but also go to my YouTube channel, Sean Cornelius Entertainer, and you can watch all of the episodes that are on there and subscribe to the YouTube channel first. And that's what we need to push these numbers. And have such a, I appreciate all the love and support that you guys have given myself, Denise, Smoke Through Show. And if you continue to watch on BronxNet, we have more great interviews coming up throughout the year. And that's just so appreciative. So appreciative of that. So again, I want to pop up some stuff for CP, his song, Where's the Love? But also go to his Facebook. CP Lacey on Facebook. Make sure you do that. And also Instagram. Pop that information up and then we'll you'll be able to follow this man. And then when this pandemic thing is done, then you can go back and you can catch him live. Like he says, he performs at the Apollo, but he's all over the place. And who knows, maybe you can, he's one of those guys that you can reach out to him and say, hey, do you do this person? Do you do that person? Can you develop this person? And maybe he'll do it. So again, if you have any more questions that you would like to ask CP during the show, all you have to do is pop them up on the screen and we'll get them to answer some of those questions. So this so far has been a really good time. And I think he's afraid. I don't think he's scared or afraid, but I think, you know, he's trying to get himself extra ready because he did say his wife is going to be there. So he's got to answer these questions. Real, so you know, you guys know how the love seat can be. The love seat can be a little bit hot on some folks, and some folks can handle it well. So I see he's getting himself ready back there in the green room. So we're gonna bring him back. As soon as he gives me the thumbs up, we'll bring him back through. Is you guys, Denise and Smoke, you guys working, helping him out back there? Is he ready? All right, here we go. Let's bring back our guest back out to the show. And wait a minute, that's not CP.
Yo, what's up, my nephew? Snoop D-O-double-G in the building, baby.
Snoop, what's going on, brother?
Yeah, Snoop Lion in the place.
Yeah, how you doing, bro?
I'm chilling. Ooh, wee, you know how I do.
A Snoop. All right, cool. So are you filling in for CP on some of these questions, or you just popped in for a second?
Oh, this that love thing you talking about right there?
Yeah, this the love section. Yeah.
This Nah. Let me take this stuff off, man. I ain't trying to talk.
Hold on. That looks good, though, man. I want to thank you for stopping by, though. I didn't know I was going to have CP and James Brown stop by, and you know what I mean? And Snoop Dogg is in the building. So this is awesome, man. I appreciate you.
Yeah, baby. You know how I do. West Coast in New York City. Yeah, I'm loving this. Where y'all at? New York City or where? Where you at, Sean?
Yes, sir. So I'm in the Bronx right now. We're in New York City in the Bronx.
I feel you on that.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So Snoop, I know maybe you can come back one night and sit with me, man, if you don't mind.
I don't know about talking about love, baby. I got to I got to I don't know about that, nephew.
Snoop, I done seen you kick back and be mellow and talk about love, because you got love for a lot of folks, a lot of things, a lot of situations.
Yeah, I got love and everything, but you know, I might jump out there and say something I don't mean, and then y'all be holding me to it. You feel me?
Well, I know you have a wife, and so you know about love and experience love. You've been with your baby boo for a long time.
Well, that's what I'm talking about right there. That's why my show didn't last very long, you know, because when they didn't see me smoking weed or introducing my knuckles to my wife, they was like, yo, man, so when you gonna break out the weed? And I'm like, yo, this a family show, man. This not that. So I got canceled because I wouldn't be that dude they thought I was. And you see?
You have never been anybody that you know, but yourself. You didn't let nobody dictate anything. That's what we love about you, Snoop.
Yeah. Well, you know, like Sammy Davis, I got to be me.
Yeah, man. Well, I appreciate you stopping by, Snoop. So, I won't hit you with the questions. If you want to grab CP and holler at him, come on back. We ready. We'll get into that situation.
All right. Walking down the street, smoking in dope. Yeah, that was fun.
Yeah, that was all right, brother. Never know who's going to pop up. So
Never know.
All right, CP. Let's get into this love thing, brother.
How you like these glasses? I created these.
Those are smooth. Hold on. Let me give you a close-up so we can see what's happening.
Yeah.
Smooth.
Created those. I painted those myself.
Okay.
They used to be my Michael Jackson glasses.
Okay. All right. And you got them matching the jacket there.
You got to, man. You have to, like, listen, hear me now. You don't know. Like my old-time granny used to tell me, you must match up everything you wear there, so. You don't know.
Yeah. It's a beautiful thing. All right, man, let me put you on the romantic funny man's love seat.
Yeah, enough shenanigans and tomfoolery.
The people love this section, so I'm sure they're gonna have a good time with this one as well. First one, out the box, love. What is your definition of love, and why is it important to you?
Okay, now, I'm going to let you know right off the bat, Sean, I'm not going to avoid any of the questions.
Well, I hope not, brother.
And I'm not going to try to be funny. I'm going to try not to be funny because I know this is a serious part of the show.
No, but listen, it's however you feel it, bro. It's not,
yeah, but I'm going to give it to you how it comes to me. Okay. Now this is the real me. You're getting it.
Hold on. You got to get one little piece of your makeup off it's looking at me on my left side, but it's probably on your right side, right off the side of your face, right off the side of your lips. Hey, there you go. I'm here for you. I'm here for you, brother.
Thank you. See, some other people would just let that stay right there. And at the end of the show, they'd be writing all kinds of comments. What was that junk on his lips?
Yeah.
All right. So the question was,
what is your definition of love and why is it important to you?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Definition of love is strength, forbearance, fortitude, and just out and out strength and power.
Okay.
Why ask me why do I say that? I heard you getting ready to ask that question.
Well, I was gonna say, why is it important to you? Yeah.
Why is that important to me? Because I do know from the Bible, coming from a Bible
And I've been, you know, down with the scriptures for a very long time. And people think that the opposite of love is hate, but the opposite of love is fear. And the Bible says, well, God didn't give us a spirit of fear, but of love. So that makes those two contrary. Okay. So that's why I say love is power, strength, fortitude. And it's important to me because if you're going to make it through this world, you're going to make it either through the venue of love or through the venue of fear. And love is more important. That's why love is important to me, because fear takes you nowhere. But love, through its power, will take you wherever you want to go.
Gotcha. Sweet. All right. Romance. What is your definition of romance, and why is that important to you?
Romance is important to me because it's something that we all want, whether you want to claim that or not, whether you don't want to claim yourself as a romantic. We don't have to all be a romantic to enjoy romance, but everybody likes romance. I mean, the worst thug standing on the corner of Utica Avenue and King's Highway, you know, wants romance, would love somebody to, you know, cuddle them and say, yo, boo, you my boo, you so crazy. You know, we all want that. So I believe that romance is been around forever. So, it's sustained the test of time. So there must be some kind of good that's going on with romance. I've never seen romance offer something that's not good. If that answers your question, I don't even know what the question was.
you were dancing around with it, brother. I know you're a great.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I was trying to give my definition of my world of romance. I don't know how the thugs in Brooklyn got in there.
Yeah, but yeah, but it's okay because it is about whatever your definition is. So, with that answer, on a scale of 1 to 10, what is your number? What is your level of how romantic is CP Lacey on a scale of 1 to 10?
I'm romantic, I believe, I would say about 11. I'm okay. About 11.
All right. Okay. Now, there's another part to that question as well. Go ahead. I'm listening.
Okay. My wife is okay with that answer. Good. Okay.
I was going to check and see if she was prompting you for certain things.
No, she's not even in here. I just want to hear you. 11? You're dreaming.
Okay, so we're going to help her because my next question is, or not question, but, you know, could you do me a favor and give us a sample of what makes you an 11? What action have you done in your romantic life that would make you say, I'm an 11, Sean?
I would say it's like your first a guest that you had on your show prior to me said you have to read the signs. Read the signs, because you don't want to come in and be romantic Joe 24/7. Read the signs and find out when it's time to be romantic, when it's time to be on a scale from 1 to 11, when it's time to be a 3, when it's time to be a 2, when it's time to be a 9, you know? So I believe that knowing the signs of your significant other and then apply the romantic therapy accordingly.
Okay, so all right, so I got to pull you back around to the question.
Go ahead.
Can you give us a sample of what you've done to make you an 11? Like, give us an example.
An 11?
Yeah, well, you said you were an 11. What have you done in your romantic efforts that makes you an 11? A sample of it, or example.
For example, dance with her, sing her favorite song. See, you have to. Men think different than women. Very small things. You don't have to come home with 12 dozen roses. That's good and everything, but you know, she would love more a physical touch.
Mm-hmm.
A physical touch is much more romantic than flowers that's going to sit on a vase and look cute. You know.
Right. So that's perfect, and that's a perfect example of something. Okay, give me 3 things that are attractive to you about women. 3 things that attract you to a woman.
Let's see. Them weaves down to the floor. Oh, them down to the floor weaves.
Everybody likes a good weave, I guess.
Of course I'm being funny right now.
Of course you are.
Sure. No. Ain't nothing wrong with you women who wear weaves. I love your weaves. You look pretty nice and awesome and stuff. But the three things that, I'd say a look in the eye. There's a look in a woman's eye. There's a certain look that's different from everybody, different to everybody. Like a look, that same look that a woman can give me that would do something to me may not work for you. But if a woman gives you that look that works for you, that would be the number one thing I'm saying, that look, okay. That special look.
Okay, the look is one.
Okay, the look is one. And then her ethic, her work ethic is number two.
Okay.
Work ethic is number two. We're in a different age now where women are bosses. Women are bossing. They're getting their paper now. And I'm not mad at that. Get your paper, girl.
Right.
And don't settle. Do not settle. Okay, so when I see a boss lady, I'm not intimidated. I'm applauding, you know, the boss. So it's the look in the eye. It's the boss lady. And the third thing is, I guess, I don't know if this is the answer to that question, because how they look in a sundress, could that be the third one?
Yeah, that's different.
Oh my God, yeah. Women, sundresses. I mean, I can look, I can't touch, but there's something, ever since sundresses came out as a fashion for women, women just look so wonderful in their sundresses in the summertime.
Okay, all right, cool. So let's go to the other side. Three things that you don't appreciate about women, that you don't like, that are turnoffs.
I believe that would be, number one would be how some women don't let it go. Don't let it go. You know, you can have an argument, and I've been married for quite a few years. I'm not talking about my wife, and I'm just talking about some women in general. And you have an argument, the argument is squashed. I'm so glad that when our arguments are squashed, for the most part, they are squashed. But you have some women have an argument, squash it, and then, 3 months, 4 months down the line, you could spill something on the floor. Oh, see, yeah, that's so crazy. And why was you with that woman anyway?
What? Right, right, right.
I thought we let that go.
Yeah, I know.
That's number one. Are we, mm-hmm. That's number one, right?
Yeah, that's one.
Another thing that I don't like about women, I would say, is, I have to think about this, because that was my main peeve. What I don't like. Wow, Sean. I said I'm going to watch all of your shows so I can be ready for anything you throw at me. But I can almost say that was the only one thing I don't like about women.
Okay.
Now, when the show is over, of course, I'm going to think of 15 things.
Right. Yes, that's how it usually happens. But okay, because it's some of the things are very simple. You know,
yeah.
they're not as much, it doesn't take as much thought, but I get it. When you have to think about it, you're like, wait a minute. So I'll let you, maybe by the time the interview is over, you might drop the other two. So let's move on. We can move on to this. And I like this question because it's a thinker. Okay. You have respect, trust, and honesty, right? Respect, trust, and honesty are important for your relationship. Tonight, at this moment, you're allowed to take one of those out, and your relationship will survive. Which one would you take out of the equation out of respect, trust, and honesty?
I can take one of them out and still survive in the relationship.
Yes, sir.
I would take out I definitely leave respect in, because as long as you have respect, those other two will have to fall under that rule. So I would take out trust.
Right. You take trust out. Okay, yeah. That's cool. No problem. All right, here's a little fantasy for you, fantasy thing. You're walking down the street, you kick a bottle by accident, all of a sudden a genie pops out. It's a low budget genie. It could be me. You don't have three wishes, CP. You have one wish for love. For the rest of your life, what is your one wish for love for the rest of your life?
Okay. Okay. The genie pops out, and this is from the heart. Genie, you can go back in the bottle.
you can go right back in that bad boy. I have the love of my life with me right now. Simple as that.
Okay. That was very good. That was very good. I can't argue with knock that. No one has ever even thought about that. You are the first person to give an answer like that. So that was beautiful.
I didn't even have to think about that. That was, right. Yeah,
and I know you meant that. That was fantastic. That was wonderful. All right, CP, here we go. I got a game to play.
Games? I like games.
Yeah, I got a game to play with you, man. This is called Favorite Seven. All right? And you watched the show before.
Oh, yeah. This is going to kill me.
So Favorite Sevens, I'm going to say something. You're going to give me your Favorite Seven, and we're going to move on. All right? Here we go.
Is Daryl still there? Can I ask Daryl for some help? Is he still online with us?
What's your favorite food?
Oh, that's easy. My favorite food is coconut rice and peas.
Okay. Coconut rice and peas. Gotcha. Favorite song all time?
I think my favorite all time song is like you're saying, like if that song came on right now, I'd stop the interview and start getting it in.
Yes, sir.
Okay. That would have to be, I'd have to say, doggone it, this is how we do it.
Okay.
And you know why I think that? Because I always tell people, when I'm industry people, I said, I wish I would have been in the studio when they first cut that song and were listening to it after, that's a rap, now let's listen to it. And they first listened to This Is How We Do It. They probably said, oh my God. This is an anthem right here. I mean, that's how I feel about that song. That song, woo, that was a banger. That was a banger and a half.
All right. Favorite song, that's good. All right, favorite movie of all time?
Favorite movie of all time is, was Training Day.
Okay.
Because it bumped out Which Way Is Up. But now that Training Day is out of my system, Which Way Is Up jumped back into the top spot.
All right, good. Favorite book you've ever read? Favorite book, all-time book?
Favorite book? Napoleon Hill, The Laws of Success.
All right. Favorite vacation spot?
Atlantis, Virgin Islands.
I've been there.
It's nice, right?
Yeah, beautiful. Okay, let's see. And I switch up these questions or these favorite sevens depending on who's sitting in that chair. Favorite, well, you might have told us, but I'm just going to go back to it. Favorite artist that you impersonate all time?
I usually answer that with a joke, which I'll say first, then I'll tell you who it is. My favorite act that I do is the one that's paying the most money at that particular day. Ha ha ha. Boing.
Good answer. Boom, boom.
Yeah. Boom, boom. Thank you. That's what I was looking for. Let's do that again. I guess the favorite act is the one that's paying the most money that day.
Boom, boom.
Thank you very much. We move on. I see I'm dealing with myself. Two maniacs on the show tonight, folks.
Exactly.
But my favorite, I believe, like I said before, is James Brown. James Brown, hands down. I get to sing, I get to dance, I get to do splits, and I'm still doing splits, thank God, at this stage of my career. I looked at all the James Browns out there, and I kind of like pat myself on the back. A lot of them stopped doing splits. So I still got a split in me, but I don't just dole them out willy-nilly. The check has to be a certain amount before you get a split out of me nowadays as James Brown.
Right, so the check has to be good for James Brown, for Tina Turner. You're getting up there at that age where it's like, listen, the hazards of my job, so got to pay for it.
I can break a hip doing a split.
Yes, sir. I feel you. Exactly. All right. Last one. Favorite time of the day for you to make love in a 24-hour period?
I'd have to say, is there a favorite time? I'd have to say the best time is in the morning, but favorite time is that spontaneity. That's it for me. Spontaneous, whatever. What?
All right. With that answer, CP Lacey, you are now at the Romantic Funny Man's Love Seat. Hey, man, I love you, brother. Thank you so much for coming through. I appreciate you. And before we get out of here, I know you want to do a little something. I'm going to do my close. And you need to, well, I've been posting where they can find you, your CP Lacey.
www.cplacey.com.
Yes, and that one is going to come up right now. That's where that is. And you know, as I close out the show, I always ask my guests to give a final word to send the people off to sleep. You need a second?
No, what I had planned to do was let a person who's very philosophical in nature and very wise with a lot of wisdom. Well, I would let him do it.
I would love to
do it because I want it from my heart. I want to say it from my heart.
It's up to you, brother. You do how you want to do.
I was going to let Flavor Flav do it, but all jokes aside, Flav, you're going to have to wait till next show. All right.
We'll have you back, brother.
I will say this. Final word is for those of you, especially those of you in performing arts, I will say, and this goes to whatever role you play in your life, because we're all, like Shakespeare said, the world is a big stage. We're all playing parts. Whatever it is that you do, don't do it. Follow your passion with your heart. Follow it with your heart and with all of your being, and the money most times will come. Don't do it for the money. Do it for the passion and the love of what you do, and the money will come. Basically, that's all I have to say about that.
CP Lacey, thank you so much, brother. From Denise to Giorgio Cooney, program director. Very entertaining. Thank you, CP. And also from producer Tyreek Mustakim Smoke. Thanks, CP, for coming through. And thanks to all of you for spending some of your holiday weekend with us. Stay blessed. Hey, man, listen, do this. Got to do this again sometime.
For sure.
You know what I mean? So for everybody over there on Facebook, thank you so much for tuning in and supporting. Again, don't forget to go to and subscribe to my YouTube channel, Sean Cornelius Entertainer. And as I always say in parting, please go with God in your heart. Have a peace of mind. Have a wonderful, wonderful tomorrow. And please, folks, be safe. We know something's going on out there. Wear your mask, social distance, wash your hands, hand sanitize like CP. If you're not doing it for yourself, do it for us. And from Lula Mae and Cornelius's baby boy, I'm the Romantic Funny Man, Sean Cornelius, saying good night. God bless you. And I'll catch you around the corner on the next episode of After Dark with Sean Cornelius. CP, love you, brother. Thank you so much. Stick around. Don't go nowhere.